And we are back. Couch Company Podcast. I'm John. With me, as always, Tyler.
Holy cow, you nailed it.
Yeah, I nailed it.
Yeah.
That was hilarious last week.
I thought the opening last week was hilarious. And if anyone hasn't listened to it, you should. How long, did you practice at all this week? So you just, it just came back to
I was about to okay, I got to nail it next week. And then I was like, fuck that, dude.
Yeah, you're just going to get in your head.
Just going to get in my head. The problem last week was I was just totally zoned. Yeah. And then the music started. I was like, all right, yeah. Wait a minute. I'm supposed to do something.
That's
right
my
now.
Role.
Yeah. I feel like we didn't record for a couple weeks.
Yeah.
But you feel like you do something 90 times.
This will be 97.
Yeah. You should be able to nail it, but whatever. I don't care.
We're getting there. I think July will be the 100th. Of course, you're out next week or something?
No, at the end of the month.
End of the month? Okay.
For 2 weeks.
And you're gone for 2 weeks.
Yeah, we'll talk about what we're going to do.
Yeah, we got to figure something out.
We're going to figure it out.
Okay.
We're going to put our brains together.
What's going on?
Two brains better than one, right?
Usually.
I feel like that's not always the case, though, because if two people have bad ideas, it kind of scales.
What if they have conflicting ideas?
Then you probably are are we assuming one person's right, one person's wrong?
I don't know. What is right and wrong?
2 + 2 = 4, that's right. Mm. 2 + 2 = 3 is wrong.
Sure.
I mean, you can, that's a true statement.
Well, I still don't believe in math, but that's a whole other.
You don't believe in math?
No.
Can we dive into that a little bit?
It's just, I feel
a
like.
Scam?
People, yeah. Okay. What do you really need math for? When you really think about it.
If I have 2 apples.
Yeah.
And I bought 2 apples.
Yeah.
How many apples do I have?
You have 4 apples.
Okay. How do we describe that?
I got more apples.
Okay. Interesting. So in your world, nothing is there's no.
The only 2 things I hate in my world are math and trees.
Okay.
I think it's well documented over the 97 episodes of our podcast.
No, yeah, you are weak to tree.
Also Elden Ring, but and the Batman. So all of those 4 things, those are my 4 main pillars of hatred.
You need one more just to make it a nice top 5 thematic for the show.
Top 5 things I hate the most.
Yeah.
Grand Theft Auto's got to be up there.
No. No. Let's really relax a little bit here.
All right.
I'm trying to think too now.
Nazis, maybe?
Well, yeah, but that, I feel like that's a free bingo.
Yeah.
Well,
that's my 5th. I mean, you only need 4 pillars and you hold up a roof, right? Depending on how big the roof is, I guess you need the middle pillar. I don't know what we're talking about right now, but that's the kind of...
You absolutely need a middle pillar, right?
5 pillars is a lot of pillars, man.
Well, do you want your house to fall down?
I don't want pillars in my house. That's just a weird... I'm a modern...
Yeah.
Deco.
Keep going.
Deco modern.
Yeah.
Aesthetic.
Yeah. Yeah, you and me both.
I hate old houses. I don't know.
Really?
Yeah.
How come?
Probably just because I lived in one my whole life. And I'm just saying,
How long have you lived here?
Here?
Yeah.
In the apartment?
Yeah.
We're going on 6 years.
6 years here, and then a couple years the other apartment.
Yeah.
So you might...
So 6 years here, 3 years at the other apartment, 1 year at the previous one.
Okay, so 10. So, okay, so you have lived most of your life in an old home.
Yeah.
And then about a third of your life in an apartment.
Yeah, about two-thirds in the old home, a third of my life in the...
Old people's home.
An apartment.
Yeah, okay. So, yeah, that's a fair critique, I suppose.
So far, yeah.
Well, I don't know.
You get to see my house today. I'm excited.
I'm excited, too. Apparently, you've been talking it up quite a bit, so...
You're going to walk in, you're like, what? What is this?
Yeah, is it just totally empty?
It's bad, yeah.
Yikes. How's that going? We're getting there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's okay.
All right.
We're still waiting on some stuff.
Yeah. But it's dry.
Yes. especially because... So the thing I'm worried about now is it's been 80 degrees. So
yeah.
I don't know what that does to a...
To a completely empty home.
Yeah, because I don't want to put the air conditioning on in there. Why would I? Heat's not going to do anything to it.
God, dude.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, well.
It's not obviously you need to put the heat on when it's freezing because you don't want the pipes to freeze and things like that. But when it's hot, people don't have air conditioning.
It's going to catch fire?
Yeah, some people don't have air conditioning. So it's okay, let's just.
Yeah, that's true.
Hot.
It's a great point.
I don't know. What are we talking about? Pillars?
I don't know. I'm kind of an igloo guy. I want to live in an igloo.
Like like in about. Antarctica, or do you want to do like the mud glues or like the mud igloos?
No, in like the ice.
Yeah, see, I don't know about
in
that.
The frozen.
I want those blocks that are like, hey, if you make a house with these blocks, it will just keep you warm when you want to be warm and cold when you want to be cold.
Yeah, like in like New Mexico.
Perfect. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Why wouldn't you want one of those?
I don't like mud.
But you like the heat. You're like, oh, it's July. Like today is going to be wonderful for you. Like we're gonna.
I do like the heat, but I'm just curious. Like, how does an igloo work? Does it even keep them warm?
It's warmer than the cold air blowing on them.
Is the only reason? Is it made out of ice? Because that's all they have up there.
I would love to know what the percentage of people living in igloos are.
It's very low.
Probably.
It's got to be extremely low, my friend.
Yeah, but I mean,
someone is though, right? Today, maybe.
I can look it up.
No, dude, this is the fun part where we speculate wildly about how the world works. 3%? Are you out of your mind? That's way too high.
Of the people living up there?
Do you know how many... You're talking world or what?
No, I'm not saying 3% of the world population.
I was going to say, that's so many people.
No, 3% of the people that live in places that make sense to live in an igloo.
Dude, I don't even know. Now I'm... My brain's spiraling, dude.
I don't know.
Thinking about this.
You're living in the wigwams and teepees.
Does anyone even live up there in the North Pole?
I mean, Santa. Like, Alaska, people live
there. Starting to suspect that Santa might be a conspiracy.
You mean not real?
I didn't want to say that, but
I'm
questioning what's going on there.
How, like, why?
I started crunching the numbers, which you don't believe in.
Uh-huh.
And it's not, something's not adding up.
I think I ruined Santa for one of my cousins.
I hope we don't have any young listeners. Well, first off, we
shouldn't have young listeners.
We shouldn't.
So it shouldn't matter.
Yeah, we shouldn't for various other reasons.
For a lot of things.
Yeah. But especially that.
I want to say it was like a Christmas dinner or something. And I just mentioned that like Santa's not real. Or I thought like my little cousins like automatically knew that.
Yeah. Ruined their life.
I don't think it ruined their life, but I want to say that like one of the sisters knew and the other one was like, what? I mean, obviously, it was years and years and years ago. But
how did you backpedal on that one, or did you just go in?
I don't know if I did.
Yeah, I feel like at that point you're off the cliff. You just
it's like look,
you start nosediving.
Give me that knapsack.
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah, exactly. You accept your fate, and you just start explaining why it's impossible for Santa to exist.
Yeah. Well, I mean, time travel.
It could. Could be it.
Time zones, time travel. Santa could do it.
Santa might be Superman if you kind of think about it.
I think it's hard to believe that there is a person that wants to give presents to every kid in the world. I feel like that's harder to believe than the logistics of actually doing it.
No.
Like, I think people are too selfish, and I think kids don't deserve it enough. Because, like, let's be real. Everyone should be on the naughty list. Like, there's nothing that you do through... like. I have yet to meet a kid that's like, oh yeah, you're good all year round.
I mean, in December, those kids shape up real quick.
Yeah, but to me,
some last second. I agree with you. Yeah. I'm just saying.
Well, that's what I mean. So like, what if Santa is real, but no one deserves him? So it's very easy.
He's just sitting there.
He goes to that one kid from like, I don't know. Alaska,
sure.
Where they can't literally do anything, and he's just in the igloo, and he pops in, says, "Hey, here's what are they getting the kids in Alaska? Here's a piece of ice.
Here's a piece of ice.
Do you think they give ice instead of coal? Here's a new roof.
Just gives them a block of ice. That's funny.
Here's some blubber.
Yeah, I don't know, man. What if he is real though? That would be crazy.
That's what I'm saying. I think he could be.
No, he can't. Definitely not. Like, literally impossible, but what if?
What if there's so few kids? I mean, take all the Jewish kids out, right? All right, I don't know how many. Like,
ready for this theory?
Higher percentage than it.
Ready for this one?
Igloos.
Yeah. This one might expand your consciousness a little bit. Pyramids.
Yeah.
Gift from Santa Claus.
Pyramids are a gift from Santa Claus?
Yeah.
Explain.
Okay. You have ancient Egypt. I actually don't know. Santa Claus is like what? 1800s?
Probably.
What was his origin story movie?
After ancient Egypt.
Jolly Saint Nick or something?
Yeah.
Isn't there like a claymation movie that documents his origin story?
Jack Nicholas.
Is that it?
I don't know.
Jack Nicklaus. Wait a minute. That doesn't sound right. I think there is. Someone correct me. We should be receiving a message from the research department any second. Although I actually don't think the research department's a big Christmas guy, so that might be a little tough
really?
For him. Yeah, I don't
those,
think so.
He's one of those guys.
I well, bet. Dude, we're talking about a guy who had Disney Channel yeah. banned from his household when he was a kid.
Yeah, but it's like, I guess that's fair.
I feel like that's an extension.
Christian, like very Christian?
No, oh, no.
Oh, well, then why is Disney Channel banned?
I think anti-corporate.
Oh, well, I mean, Santa is like the most anti-corporate thing in the world.
No, it's not.
He's free. He's making his own toys.
Yeah, but he's the face. He's the face of...
Well, he can't help him.
The market.
He can't help that people...
Yes, he can.
Like, you think he gets a cut of all the...
No, well, if he does, then how is that not corporate?
If he does, I'm saying I don't think he does.
He has to, or else it'd be the biggest lawsuit in the world. Everyone uses his likeness. Everyone.
Yeah, yeah.
Everyone uses his likeness. I mean, that you're talking about the biggest suit that ever happened on planet Earth.
I'll give you his suit, but it's one of those things like, what does Santa have? He's fat. He has a white beard.
He's immortal.
Well, obviously, you have to be immortal if you're time traveling and jumping
around.
Yeah,
so I don't know why you're like talking about his weight before the fact that the dude never dies.
Well, it's the likeness.
Seems a little...
That's the point, is it's the likeness. So like being immortal, you know, you can't tell if he's immortal or not.
Well, that's fair.
Visually, you know what I mean? Like, so.
Well,
I don't
what
know.
Are you saying? Anyone could look like that?
Well, I'm saying it's like, can you trademark Santa Claus? Like, can
But
he...
they're using his name. That's the thing. It's yeah, you can draw a picture of Santa all day, but as soon as you start saying Santa Claus, which is his legal name,
I
you
think
see what I'm saying?
I think it's Jack
Frost is a different
no,
character.
No, Jack Nicholas Claus.
Huh?
Or Chris Kringle.
Chris Kringle.
Christopher
Didn't he
Kringle.
Change his name?
Chelsea
we're
just,
speaking to Chelsea.
Chelsea the, yeah. The I love that we're talking about Santa Claus.
Tertiary.
When it's
research
going to be
department.
90 degrees today.
Yeah, Christmas in July.
Yeah. Which is another marketing thing.
Dude, I'm telling you, it's commercial. I don't know how you can't agree with this right now.
So I can't wait for us to finally, A, get into the house.
Yeah.
Have video.
Yeah.
And people have to think that we're just smoking a lot of something while we're talking.
Dude,
right?
People like, talk like, about this.
Yeah.
We're just putting a spotlight on it. Okay. This is big.
It.
This is big Christmas. We're trying to mm-hmm. crack the case mm-hmm. here.
Yeah.
What do you think is worse?
That's
big Christmas
Chelsea's
or big
leaving.
Pharma?
I thought she'd stay and talk with us, but I guess not.
Hey, what's the origin story for Santa Claus? Like the claymation where they. Santa Claus is coming to town? Is that it? That
I
might
mean,
be
that's
it.
A song.
And it might be a movie.
I don't know.
You know what I'm talking about, though, right?
Chelsea's the.
I'm telling you, it's
Christmas
like it's Chris Kringle, and he's a dude.
Yeah.
And then it documents how he became Santa Claus.
Wasn't he a carpenter or something?
Something. He did something.
Yeah. Not Jesus, but like he was.
What if he was Jesus?
Alan.
Has a beard.
Yeah. It's old Jesus.
Immortal.
Old fat Jesus. I feel like we're getting a little sacrilegious here.
It is definitely sacrilegious, but it is an interesting prospect where it's like, you know, you'd probably put on some weight if you live forever, right?
I mean, that's
just a fact.
I don't think so.
You don't think so?
No, I think if you live forever, you get shredded.
What am I looking? Yeah. Wait, what? Where's the title?
It's the Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer movie.
No, it's not.
It's not the
Rudolph
the Red-Nosed Reindeer movie.
Yeah,
what?
But
that's not the origin of Santa
Claus. No, but
Claus.
Find him when he's young, though. Find him when he's young. Because it starts when he's like a kid. Remember the song, Put One Foot in Front of the Other? That's what that's from.
Buddy, you're barking up the wrong tree.
Santa Claus is coming to town.
Okay.
Okay, yeah. It's not Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
Is Rudolph
It does look the same.
The, oh, so it's, they
I,
use the same like,
I think
claymation.
It's a, yeah. Huh. I think it's the same cinematic universe.
I hope this translates well on the podcast.
No, none of this does.
The research department is like right here. We got instant feedback. Thanks,
yeah,
babe.
Santa Claus is coming to town.
Okay.
It's Santa Claus's origin story.
Yeah, but here's the thing.
Okay.
This is what I'm saying.
All right, tell me what
Santa
you're
Claus is real.
Yeah.
It doesn't say Santa Claus is coming around to your town. It's Santa Claus is coming to town, which means there is one town in the entire world that is deserved of Santa Claus and his gift.
Man.
Which means he goes directly to
which city?
That town.
Which town?
Probably not U.S., man. I'm telling you. Wait, okay, maybe U.S., but like Alaska.
Okay.
I think that it's a short trip.
Have you seen the movie, by the way?
Back to, no, clearly not.
Yeah, I'm going to poke a couple holes in your little theory here if you watch that one, but I enjoy where your brain's
at. Oh, you
at.
Mean the cartoon?
Claymation? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Okay. There's a lot of cartoons that document things that happened.
Yeah, like?
Like
Gumby?
Shrek?
Shrek is not claymation.
That was, wasn't that the Crusades?
What?
Yeah.
Right. Shrek is the Crusades?
Yeah, because, you know, they took his swamp and then they fought the bad guy.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I think that's what happened. Someone fact check me on that.
I swear we're
there's got to be like
sober,
a historical.
You're drinking coffee. I'm drinking water.
I don't know what you put in this.
Yeah.
Shrek might be the best kid. I was talking about this yesterday to my buddy.
Uh-huh.
He was saying, what was he saying was really good? Madagascar. He's like, oh, never dude, Madagascar's so good. I'm like, I don't know, dude. Madagascar's kind of mid. When it comes to kids' movies, like you got Shrek, dude. Yeah. Would you rather watch Shrek or Madagascar? I mean, let's be honest.
Shrek is real good. I'm trying to think of something that I would actually rather, kids movie-wise. I mean, I don't know. Like, are you saying like not Disney? Or is everything
Disney counts, sure.
So you would take Shrek over any Pixar movie?
Well, I did. I was talking about, you know, Shrek came to mind first because Shrek's just baller.
Yeah.
And the reason we started talking about Madagascar is because we were at the bar and someone on the Touchtunes started playing I Like to Move It, Move It.
Okay.
So it's like Madagascar, right?
I'll take your word for it.
Well, I'm an expert. So I was like, he was like hyping up Madagascar. He was gassing it up like, dude, this is it. And I'm like, no, it's not. I can name like a million better animated kids movies than Madagascar.
A million?
Not a million. It's hyperbole, but I can name quite a few.
Yeah.
Basically Shrek.
Every
Shrek,
Pixar
first
movie.
Of all. Not every. I don't know. There's some not amazing Pixar movies.
Have you seen all the Pixar movies?
Yeah. The Good Dinosaur, not a good movie.
That's crazy. You've seen them all. I haven't seen. I'm trying to think of the last Pixar movie I've seen. Pretty sure it was Toy Story 3.
I would 100% rather watch all the Pixar movies than all the Marvel movies. I'll tell you that.
Oof. I don't know about that one.
100%.
I don't know about that one.
Dude, after you, the Infinity Saga, after that, it's like, why am I even doing
this?
Dude,
I'm still waiting for you to take the 64 and then, hours.
And then half of the one in the Infinity Saga are like, okay. Like Iron Man 3, like we're really going to sit here for 2.5 hours?
Iron Man 3 was better than
hash this out?
Than a lot of them. I'm going to just
then what?
Than a lot of, like, all the Ant-Mans.
Yeah, exactly. Ant-Mans, Thors.
I don't know. Thor is my
first,
favorite.
The
one.
First couple, like, first
yeah,
couple
Ragnarok's
were awful.
Great.
Yeah, not awful,
okay.
But
the
it was
second
like
one
fine.
Was the second worst movie.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. Dark World awful.
Second worst.
Ant Man's terrible. The first Dark Hulk World. Doesn't even have the right guy in it. They forgot who was Hulk.
Put Ruffalo in.
Yeah. I mean, what a blunder that was.
Some weird stand-in.
Wasn't available that day.
He was taking a siesta. He was too busy filming the Avengers. He was like, all right, well, someone else can stand in.
That's
efficiency
right there. Film two movies. Wow. Anyways, Shrek, Aladdin comes to mind immediately.
Yeah.
As just a fantastic Toy Story.
I was talking to one of my friends. They liked the live action of Aladdin.
That's not a valid opinion.
I completely
that's
agree.
That's actually not a valid opinion.
I listed out very quickly why Aladdin sucks.
I don't.
She kind of went back on it. But.
Can you reiterate for the audience?
Yeah,
just
you,
in case
you,
we have anyone.
You destroy Iago.
Yep.
The fact that you have
one of the
to,
greatest villains of all time.
You have to. Sure.
You don't think
anti-hero,
so?
Anti-hero, obviously.
Anti-hero?
Yeah, I would say
well,
anti-hero.
You have to watch the whole
yeah, you have to see the arc. But
it is an arc.
Yeah.
It's
even in the first movie when he's just bad, he's still great.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's why I consider him a villain.
I think that the fact that you have to artificially speed up or slow down the dances just to get in line with the music is insane.
I'm going to be honest with you right now. I haven't seen it.
Well, you should see it.
I just should to, not.
I, ooh, how.
You're going to burn hours on that? Are
we,
you serious?
Dude, we have to start churning through some of these hours.
We're going
to
have a miserable.
I'm done with, I am done with Justice League.
And?
So there is that.
But it's favorite fine. Show of all time? 10 out of 10?
Sorry, buddy.
No.
Sorry, buddy. Well, hold on. So Iago is just gone.
Sure.
Abu is there, but again, he's a monkey.
He's like actually like, a monkey.
Actually a monkey.
Yeah.
Gone.
Yep.
So all the
it's
interactions
like
are terrible.
Live action takes away all the like
all the charm of
charm
yeah,
and
that is.
Magic of
Jafar is like hot Jafar. So they're doing this thing where like all the villains are like.
He was okay in the animated. He wasn't hot, but he was.
He was.
He had a little.
He was like old. Like the whole thing was like in this one, I could see like, yeah, Jasmine could fall for Jafar.
Yeah.
Like in the cartoon,
I'm sure
like,
he's very hot in this. Yeah, I just I'm going to bat for OG Jafar a little bit.
Aladdin doesn't get sent to Siberia at all. There's no giant snake at the end.
Siberia.
Yeah. Well, he gets like shot up. Like, trapped in like one of the towers and then knocked into like a snowstorm.
Yeah.
And then he walks.
That's one
all
of your points.
Way. I think that's a big deal. Like Jasmine getting thrown into an hourglass.
Yeah.
And then having to get like rescued and then like the big giant snake and turning into a genie and all of that stuff.
I get that. The Siberia thing. I don't.
Instead, Jasmine just sings a song about,
I don't know,
like how hot Jafar is. And
really?
And then she saves the day.
Oh, she saves the day.
I don't think so, but she doesn't. She is not in any peril.
Yeah.
There was like a little
sure.
tweak on that plot point.
Well, she does have like a tiger. You think like
I don't think she does. She have a tiger? Is
she
Raja in the live action Chels?
Has to.
Okay, well
for
fine.
Like one second.
Fine, take the tiger out of it too in terms of any type of charm or anything like that.
Well, the tiger didn't do much in the OG.
He had some funny bits.
The only one I remember was like Aladdin's picking her up for the date.
Yeah, and then he says, like, hey, like, hey, go on, take off all your clothes or something. Or good teenagers take off their clothes.
Not really.
You remember that in the Aladdin movie?
No.
Whenever, so he goes to pick her up in the cartoon.
Yeah.
And this was like a big conspiracy theory.
Sure.
And the Raja, the tiger, is like growling at him and like pounces on him, right?
Yeah.
And he's like, he takes his hat off and starts like shooing him away.
Right.
And I forget what the line, like the line was supposed to be like, go on, get out of here, go on, take off and leave, or something like that.
Yeah.
But then if you, like, listen to the whispers or whatever in the Disney movie, it's, like, all good teenagers take off their clothes or something.
What?
So it's, like, this big, like, sexual thing. Same thing with, like, Little Mermaid. The little, like, Pope guy gets, like a boner, and, like, you have Simba, like, dropping on, like, his stomach on, like, one of, the, like, the cliffs, and then, like, all the breeze comes up and it spells out sex.
Yeah,
and stuff
yeah.
like that. You know, like
I remember that
those.
One.
And then we did talk about the Rescuers, where somebody actually spliced in boobies, and like as they're like flying by in one of the windows, there's just like a chick like flashing.
Yeah,
that is true, and I have the video for that one.
That's fantastic.
Amazing. Yeah.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Anyway, that's a deep dive into the conspiracy.
There's Tyler's child.
What I'm saying
right
is
there.
live action Aladdin sucks.
Absolutely.
Like it's terrible.
No, I agree. I mean, first of all, why? I mean, money, but
yeah,
I don't know.
And then you go back and you watch like Chelsea actually. So we watched the live action, and I think it was for like one of my birthdays or something, or maybe just out of the goodness of her heart. But then she goes and buys me like the 4K. Like, here's the good Aladdin.
She's about to correct what you just said. So
yeah. Okay.
Oh, that's right. Okay.
Yeah. So
misread the face there.
But then we immediately watched that, and it was like, okay, this is perfect. Like the fact that you have to say, and I kind of sidestep this whole thing because it's like the fact you have to say like Will Smith wasn't bad as the genie, but he was no Robin Williams. Like he did what he could do. It's like, look, if you have to say that, if you're like, well, no one's ever going to beat Robin Williams, why try? Why are you doing this?
Yeah, I don't know. Because money, dude. They're trying to literally run the gambit back of all the things. So, like, hey, remember when you guys loved this, and then cash in on it because it's easy. It's already written for you.
I know.
Just like Marvel. Comic books are already written.
I guess that's true. Yeah, but
let's
Marvel's
just cash
even,
it in.
Even screwing that up. And then I will be interested to see kind of what the movies are going to be doing for Star Wars. Speaking of like Marvel and Disney and all that stuff.
Dude, I'm so... There's too much. Actually, I was talking to the research department the other day, as I do.
Uh-huh.
And I think his theory is pretty good on this, where it's... At this point, they are only catering, I guess, if you want to use that word, to people who are invested.
Yeah.
So, like, people like me who are on the outside are just left in the dust.
Yeah.
And they're really just focusing on people who have consumed the whole catalog of Star Wars, for example.
Yeah, but it's such a shame because, like, you are missing out on some, like, good stuff, but you have to weed it through
100%
trash.
Yeah, 100%. But that's the marketing strategy.
Did you see... So you have not seen Kenobi, I assume, right?
No.
Well, now...
My God.
Now you can watch a two-hour fan cut of Kenobi where he basically just, like, redid it.
Yeah.
Like, recut it.
Yeah.
It's a two-hour movie. Everyone's, like, raving about it. Gets a call from Lucasfilms.
Right.
And who's the director in Iron Man? Not Filoni. Dave Filoni's one of them. Like, but who played Happy?
Feige?
Hogan?
Oh.
What was it? Was it Ben? Yeah, Farrow.
What?
John
Favreau.
John Favreau, thank you.
There we go.
Man,
that was a little
really nice
alley-oop there.
It.
I put it in, really though. Nice I got it in. Little baseball reference for you.
But they call him up, and they're like, hey, let's get this on Disney+.
It was a basketball reference. I was
testing you. I immediately... You say layup?
I said it was a little alley-oop, but I put it in.
I could do an alley-oop.
And then I said, that's a baseball reference.
A baseball? Really, basketball reference.
Really honing in to see if you would catch that little
trip up. You start talking
about you've been doing
balls.
Good on the sports talk.
It's
that's
basketball.
You like basketball.
No, I don't.
You're the home run hot dunks.
Yeah.
What do you think the hot dunks is?
Well, home run comes first. That's a baseball term.
You think that's a donut thing?
Home run, hot dunks, and then ace is my thing, which is a...
Do you think a dunk from a donut came before a dunk from a basketball?
Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah.
But maybe not.
Ancient Egyptians had donuts.
No, they didn't.
Yeah, they did.
Do you want a cheeseburger that?
1,000%.
Are you serious?
Yes. Do you want to put 100 cheeseburgers on that?
I don't like this. I kind of do, though. I kind of do.
Ooh.
You're fucking with me, man. I love the play, though. That's ballsy.
Buddy, this is what you call buying the pot.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not whatever we're smoking, but the pot in the middle of 100 cheeseburgers.
I feel like the conversation we're having has gone far beyond
marijuana. I just think that anything worth talking about, you could contribute to the ancient Egyptians, and I feel like 90% of people would just believe you.
I didn't believe you, and I still don't.
Yeah.
Donuts were invented in the United States of America.
No.
Yeah, maybe not.
No.
I don't know.
Maybe Italy.
Italy?
If I had to pick one.
Are you serious?
If I had to pick one, first donut was created.
I'll say U.S.
Italy,
you say Italy,
can I
and
get
if it's
Italy
neither?
Or France, and then you do U.S.?
Well, you can't get two.
I'll do Italy, France. You get the field.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah.
Done.
Where was the first donut created?
I think it was the U.S.
Well, I got to spell it correctly.
An important piece to this process here.
Because if you're spelling donut D-O-N-U-T instead of D-O-U-G-H-N-U-T-S.
Wait, what?
I don't know. Donuts are deep fried cakes with long European history and roots in still earlier Middle Eastern cuisine.
Okay.
They were introduced to America by the Dutch in New Netherlands to America as oliekoeken, or oil cakes or fried cakes. That's the history of the donuts. So I guess, I mean, just by default, you win there, but...
Yeah, you shouldn't have gave me the field. We would have tied. I was about to give you a tie.
That's fine. I'll take a...
But I was going to say my second pick was the Netherlands, so you still would have lost.
That would have been... Yeah.
It would have been good.
If you would have picked the Netherlands,
how good would that be? There, I feel like that's
probably could have got.
That's
a
top five dessert country, right?
Netherlands,
probably.
I don't know.
Aren't they known for stuff?
Maybe, isn't it?
I wanted to say chocolate, but I'm not 100% sure.
I thought the whole point of like European stuff is like they're not as like sweet. Like they're a little bit more like.
They have amazing sweets.
Do they?
Oh, yeah.
I thought they were like, they didn't like sweet stuff. Like, Americans are all about like
sweet
the
stuff.
Sugar and like just blast your mouth out of your face.
Let's correct this. Our sweet stuff is not the same as their sweet stuff.
That's what I'm saying.
So, yeah, but it is sweet stuff. They have great desserts. They have
It's mildly sweet by our standards.
Honestly, one of the best desserts all time.
Uh-huh.
Speaking of Italy,
yeah.
The cannoli.
Yeah.
Oh, Tyler. This is why we're never going to make it to 100 episodes.
We're so close.
It's just things like this, man. Like cannolis? Really?
Yeah, they're okay.
They haven't
had one that's like, oh my gosh, this is a
you gotta have
great
a good one.
Cannoli. Yeah.
See, cannolis are not like pizza, where like bad pizza is still eating pizza. Bad cannolis,
even pizzas, I've been getting some bad ones recently.
You might be getting sick of pizza.
Chelsea and I were just talking about this. Like, I think we might have been. We skipped out on Thursday's BOGO pizza.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's when you know it's bad.
Yeah. We're just like, it's been bad.
Permanis was pretty bad the other time we had it at D&D.
Mm-hmm.
It was so undercooked. I think the delivery is the problem. I think you got to pick it up.
Yeah. Well,
or go in.
You also have to say, like, I want this well done. But then you have to, like, talk to a waitress and be like, when I say well done, like,
I mean, keep that sucker to the ground, in there. Yeah.
I think that just Thursday, they're going through slammed, so many pizzas. 100%. They have to get them in and out.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. That I'd rather a burnt pizza than a...
It's insane to me, though, because, like, we've been doing Zuppas and getting, like, the Italian club, which is phenomenal.
Oh, my God.
But that's, like, a $40 delivery.
What?
Yeah, it's because it's,
how
like...
How much is the sandwich?
$13 for the sandwich. Yeah. $13.99 for the sandwich. And I found out that cranberry and Wexford are actually a $3 difference. So it's like $17.
Whoa,
in cranberry. And it's only $13 in Wexford. So if you were to go to Zuppas and get the Wexford one, it's cheaper.
Everything's more expensive in cranberry.
But you have that. It's a $7 like delivery fee. So like, and then you have to do the tip for Uber.
Right.
It's insane.
That's disgusting.
$40.
Yep.
Or for $28, and this is including tip.
Yeah.
You get two large, you get 24 slices of pizza.
Or how about I give you this one? $30 and you get Ratchet and Clank Rift Apart.
Yeah. Right now, I don't even know if that's going to go through Monday, but if you're listening to this, maybe check out the PlayStation
sale. You should remind me tonight to grab Ghost those of, two.
Tsushima and...
Tsushima?
It's T.
It is, but it's silent.
Yeah.
Tsushima.
And apparently it's not, like, there's a PS5 version of that, but it's technically a PS4 game.
So right? It's $30 on the PlayStation store?
I think so. Okay. It's a couple cents less. Yeah. So it's either Amazon or the digital version.
Well, I'm going to get the digital version.
Yeah, why wouldn't you? Sure.
Well, if you're a collector.
Yeah, but is that really what... I guess those are both...
I will say, dude, I was talking to someone about this. Sucker Punch made Ghost of Tsushima.
Yeah.
And those are the guys who made Sly Cooper, bro.
Yeah.
I love that. I love following the career of a studio.
Yeah.
Because they started off as like so tiny.
All my favorite studios, I think, have closed down.
But here's the thing.
Or they're not.
Here's the thing you have to look out for, though, as well, is sometimes you follow the trajectory of like a studio or a company or something. Mm-hmm. But sometimes it's more important to follow individual contributors.
Yeah.
Because they might leave.
That's what I mean.
You know what I mean?
Like, you're looking at Infinity War. Yeah. And Infinity War is still there, but the guys are... Long
Where
long.
Are they?
Yeah,
that's what we need. We need to have a big
They're
board.
They're doing Titanfall,
like a Always Sunny board.
Yeah,
where we connect the dots.
You just get all the big
and then
big
with that,
of the industry.
That's when we can predict when games are going to be good.
Because
I feel like we're not thinking about, okay, well, here's the studio. They always say the studio that brought you this and this and this, and it's like, okay, they didn't tell us the lead director's gone.
Right. Well, exactly.
Right.
But that's why, like, BioShock. Dude's gone.
Yep.
You have like Cliffy B has been gone from Gears for
exactly.
For yeah.
Although Gears is still doing well.
Rod Ferguson went in there and he actually left, and now he is the one that finished out Diablo.
Oh,
yeah. So like it gets some weird stuff. Kojima's obviously his own thing.
Yep.
And then you have the people that did COD 4 that are over and do they? I mean, they just put out Jedi Survivor.
COD 4. Really?
I see. That's what was his name? I think Mark, not Zuckerberg, but you know.
Oh, it wasn't Zuckerberg.
I think it's Mark. I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, but those two guys.
Interesting.
Which it might even be one guy now. I don't even remember. But
COD 4 was a
what
good
are we
game.
Talking about? Yeah. In conclusion, Call of Duty 4: Modern Warfare was a great game.
The more I think about it, I think it might be the greatest game ever made.
It's up there. Yeah.
It has to be in the conversation.
Do we want to talk about games?
I
know we have two things to talk about.
We mentioned Diablo. I think it's a good transition.
That's good. Yeah.
Tyler has Diablo because he's a nerd.
I spent the Ultimates Deluxe. So I didn't realize that there was actually a middle tier.
Oh, that you could also get the game.
So I just dropped the hundo. But I get the season. I get the first season pass.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Are you like you buy those consistently or?
The season passes?
Yeah.
This is the first time a Diablo has a season pass.
Oh, really?
Know. Yeah.
What are the seasons that everyone always used to talk about?
Oh, those are just included. Like, that's not like a season pass where you unlock things. That's just It's a new season of Diablo. You go you do some new stuff with new mechanics and whatnot.
Gotcha.
Go all the way through, finish all the challenges, get a cosmetic at the end.
Yeah.
The season pass now is going to be like your normal battle pass, whatever.
People upset about that?
I don't know yet. I think it's too early to tell because it's not implemented yet. Like, the season pass doesn't even start until mid to late July. Like, they want everyone to play the campaign and finish the campaign up, which, like, I just started Act 3.
Out of 4?
Out of 4, okay. Yeah. So they typically do 4 acts, and then they'll do a DLC, expansion pack, which is the 5th act. Or at least that's what they did for Diablo 3. Who knows?
Okay.
But, yeah, they want everyone to finish the campaign, and then once you finish the campaign, that's how you unlock, like, your mount, which then you have in perpetuity. Like, you can just pull it out whenever. Same thing with, like, all your different... you could go in, like, different dungeons and get, like, aspects, which then you can infuse your armors and different things like that. And I'm sure that the more I tell you all these things, your eyes will just glaze over.
You always say that, dude. I'm looking at you.
No, I know. But what I'm saying is, like, it's so hard to... As my cats are fighting. Okay.
And they're getting excited about Diablo as well.
It's one of those things, like, there are so many mechanics upon mechanics upon mechanics that make it really, really, really weird. But anyway, let's step back. So Diablo 4, there's essentially two games in one. You have your campaign, which is the main story and everything. And then once you beat the campaign, you have kind of this open world, games as a service, keep making your guy better and stronger and new armors and different things and, like, see how far you can get in the world and see how strong you can get, right?
Okay.
They have a PvP aspect if you want to go down that road. So, like, there's, like, I haven't got here yet, but, like, there's, like, an area that you could just go into and anyone can kill anyone.
Mm.
So, like, let's say you make a hardcore character. Guess what? Like, your character will die. So, like, if you go into a PvP zone with a hardcore character, it's just like, if you die, you're dead.
Right.
Like, you lose everything. Yeah. So it's just like, you get this kind of like weird high risk, high reward stuff, which is crazy. But when it all boils down to it, it's literally just keep making your character stronger, better. And then, like, they'll have, like, challenge rifts and things like that. And the whole point of, like, the season pass, and this is why they're waiting a month to come out with it, is because they want you to be done with the campaign and then start doing the season pass with just like, hey, here's your open world, go around and do all these, like, little story missions and things like that. So
is it the same world as you play through the game? And
yes.
Then you just are kind of in that world after the game's over?
Okay. Yeah, it's a little weird because essentially everyone has their own world. So if you go through it, like, and this is different than D3. So Diablo 3, like, when you go into, like, essentially what is the, let's say post-campaign. So we'll put campaign to the side. You go through, you play the campaign, cool, you're done with the campaign, you'll probably never touch the campaign again. There's no reason to go through it again.
Right.
And that gets you up to level 50. And then from 50 to 70, you're playing, like, the open world. So in Diablo 3, the open world is, like, essentially not new every time, but, like, you go into it and, like, the map is completely blank and you have to, like, go through it and just, like, you just run dungeons, or not dungeons, but, like, bounties and rifts and stuff, and you're just basically doing these same things over and over again. In Diablo 4, the world is the same. So you have to go and, like, basically paint all the map in, and every section of the map has, like, hey, here's this many waypoints and this many, you know, dungeons and this many whatevers. So you can, like, 100% the map. But then on top of that, every season they're adding more, you know, storylines and extra missions and new mechanics and different things. So hopefully it keeps it fresh. But yeah, it's like, it's the same map. So wherever you leave off at the camp, like, once you finish the campaign, you're not going to have the entire map, like, opened, but there's plenty more to explore, plenty more to do, things like that. Every dungeon has been like 25, 30 minutes. Which is large.
Yeah.
But you would go, you do a dungeon, you get, like, a special ability, and then you can infuse that into your weapons and make yourself stronger and all that stuff. So, like, I don't know. It's this gameplay loop of, if you just want to watch the numbers go up, you're going to have a good time with it. I think the campaign so far has been good. I think the voice actress for Lilith, who's like not Diablo, she's like the big bad, because Diablo, we killed him in the last game, so who even knows if he's in this one. But she is very good. Like, she is probably the best, like, female acted character I've seen in a game in a while, for some reason. Like, she just, she really, really does a good job. But the story's cool enough. Super dark, super gory and gruesome and whatnot, because people, that was a criticism of D3, that is like, this isn't dark enough. We want to make it more satanic. So they were like, all right, here you go.
Yeah.
So I think overall, I'm having a lot of fun with it. I think it's an interesting choice to make it like, it's always online, so you'll feel, you'll meet people out in the, you know, wastelands or whatever. I haven't run into any of those like MMO problems where like, oh, everyone's killing this one mob and then you have to wait for it to respawn so then you can do it. Like, there's nothing like that so far.
Okay.
Which is good.
But they can interact with like things you can interact with.
You can.
Right?
So there are like these world events, which are, I think that's, it's almost like a too big of a title for it, because like they're typically like, kill everybody on the screen and you just do it and then you get a chest.
Like, right. It's like a Guild Wars thing, right?
It's a lot more like Guild Wars, yeah where it's like, if anything of note or of meaning, you basically have your own instance. All the loot's instanced, so like any loot you see on the ground, you pick it up because it's just yours.
Right.
So you don't have to worry about any of that, which I love. Like, if you had to share loot, forget it. I'm not doing that.
Can you party up with other people?
Yeah, you can party up with, I think, 4 people total.
So if you meet people out in the wilderness, you can just team up with them.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah, super easy. Like, you have, of course, you have your emote wheels. Where you can emote and do different things. They do some really smart things with that. So like dungeons, if you go in a dungeon, you finish a dungeon. Now there's an emote that just like takes you right out to the dungeon. So you don't have to like run all the way back, which is nice. I think the transmog stuff is really, really good. So in Diablo 3, you can make your, like any item you picked up, suddenly you knew the item, what it looked like. So you can make any item look like any other item. So you could always look however you want.
Right.
The cool thing with this one is you can set what your appearance is, but if you get a new piece of armor, that's fine. Your appearance stays. So like, you get to like always look the way you want to look, versus like all this, like in Diablo 3, every time you got a new piece of armor, it was like this weird, like, oh, now I look like janky until I get to town to then like transmog it. So
gotcha.
They did some smart things there. Two notable kind of missing things is like, I there's no wings, which is kind of like a, you could just like a cosmetic thing you put on your back. So we haven't seen that yet. We haven't seen pets. Pets in Diablo 3 would pick up all the gold for you, so you'd have to run around pick up gold.
Right.
Boy, does it suck picking up gold yourself. I'm assuming that once you finish the campaign, you'll get it, but we'll see.
So overall, pretty positive.
Here's the thing. Does it do anything drastically different than Diablo 3? No. Is it more of watch the numbers go up, grind, have some fun combat, like cool. Like all the bosses were fun. Like the mechanics are cool. It's a challenge. I'm playing a barbarian, so everything's very melee focused and stuff. And I finally got my rhythm down with that. And I'm starting to feel powerful.
There's 4 classes?
5. So barbarian, druid, sorcerer. Demon hunter, whatever the demon hunter is, like a rogue or something.
Yeah.
Maybe it is only. And necromancer is the 5th one.
Okay.
So yeah.
Cool. Oh, interesting.
I'm excited to play it with you.
Do you like this story?
Yeah, and I think that this is why I want to play with you story wise, and I'm sure we talked about this on the air. I've ruined Diablo 3 for you. So
yeah.
It was one of those things where we started the story, you were dipping your toes into this wonderful world of watching the loot go up and, oh, this is a better dagger and this is cool and you can spend time doing all that and whatnot. And I was like, hey, man, don't worry about any of that. Let's just blow through it and let's get to the end game because that's the fun. But again, that was selfish of me because I got to do all of the campaign stuff beforehand and all that stuff. So I promise you I will not make that same mistake.
Yeah.
So ultimately, we will play it however you want to play it, and I want to be following you as you explore, if that makes sense.
Sure.
The beauty of this versus Diablo 3, and this is just me being selfish, is if I go into your game, I can either make a new character. So if you want me to make a new character, I'll make a new character. I already said that until you get a mount, I'm not using my mount. That's like one of the only rules that I would have is like, I'm not going to be that guy running like, you know, like my steed around you. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll go at your pace. But the cool thing is like, if I go into your game, it auto levels everything based off of whoever you're going into. So I'll be able to see my open map. But it's like, okay, if I want to, do like a certain mission or something, it's locked to like your missions basically. So we would be playing like your game, but I would still get all the credit. I'd still be getting loot drops that pertain to me and stuff like that. So it's not like I'm going backwards, where Diablo 3 wasn't quite like that.
Gotcha. Okay. So, no, that's cool.
So like, I wouldn't be powering leveling you or anything. Right. So like I couldn't even if I wanted to. So it'd be like, nope, we are experiencing it your pace. And then it's up to you if you want to like go through the main campaign, just mainline the campaign. If you want to do all the side missions in between, and then you have all the dungeons. I will say, and this is just me being somewhat efficient, because all those dungeons are like a half hour each, just about every dungeon, at least what we're seeing, like Kyle was kind of pointing it out, every dungeon has a side quest eventually to it. So if you do the dungeon first, that's completely fine. You can get the aspect out of it and kind of clear the dungeon. But then if the side quest gets put on that dungeon, you still have to go back and then redo the dungeon versus doing both at the same time.
Yep.
So we found that unless you really want to do every dungeon twice, which is
there's
like hundreds, dude.
Yeah.
Like it's crazy.
Wow.
It's better just to wait for
that like, quest.
Yeah. And every dungeon is for a specific character. So like, oh, we're doing a dungeon, but it's only for like sorcerers or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Totally fine. I'm a barbarian. I can still do the dungeon. It's just whatever I get out of that dungeon gets put in my like overall account collection, and then whenever I re-roll a sorcerer, I can use that.
Oh, I see. Them. Interesting. Okay.
Yeah. Cool. So like every season, you start a new character and just run through it and stuff like that. So like you're going to be playing every class eventually. It's just what do you want to play with eventually? Yeah. So.
Cool. Yeah, I need to feel it out. I don't know how I want to play, but I think once I get in there, It'll come to me.
Yeah, I think that you'll naturally enjoy certain things. Like, I think a lot of the side quests are just, I don't know, like, filler, fluff, like, whatever.
But, yeah, see, like, I don't know.
But if it's me and you going through them and we're like, oh, Johnny has to go find a dog or something, and like, I feel like we would just be the dumb, like, this is a life or death. We have to go get Johnny's dog, whatever, and like really kind of drill it down.
Are they named characters, or is it kind of insert yourself? You know what I'm saying?
Like, what do you mean?
Like, the five characters are they, like, named? Do they have backstories?
No. So they're pretty much you insert yourself, but they are voiced, which I think is huge.
Ah, interesting.
And you can pick male or female for all of them. So you have the voice actress or actor for each
character. Yeah. So there's 10.
So it's kind of it's splitting that difference between, it's not like, I don't know, Geralt is, you know, the barbarian going in there or whatever.
Right.
But it does enough of the backstory of like, it really sets up who you are, why you're doing what you're doing, that sort of thing. Right. It's kind of cool.
Yeah. Okay.
So I will say in kind of light of that, is it as good bringing your character in as maybe Diablo 3, where Diablo 3 you were like a Nephilim and everything? Maybe not, but
a what?
A Nephilim. I don't know why I just said that. So a Nephilim is you're basically a kid from like an angel and a demon.
Oh, okay.
And you have like powers.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're humans. So
little edgelord.
I know that I was supposed to send you a video of like the history and stuff.
Still waiting for that.
I can run it down real quick for you. And like, it's like, here's a 60-second thing.
Okay.
There was an angel named Anarius.
Okay.
And a demon named Lilith. And they hooked up.
Dibs?
That's the actress that I really like. I mean, she's very good.
All right. Anyways,
they hooked up.
Yep.
They had a kid.
Yep.
Who's named Rathma, if that matters to you. And he was the first one, and they basically created Earth. It's called Sanctuary, but it's Earth, right?
Oh, okay, sure.
And they made all the humans, and all the humans are basically like half angel, half demon, super powerful.
Wait, descendants from this?
Yeah, like their kid. Like they just kept procreating.
So it's just a big tree. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yep.
And then Anarius, who's the angel, is like, oh, this could go poorly. Where like, if they wanted to overthrow heaven, they could just do that. Or if they wanted to overthrow hell or whatever. Yeah. And they're like, so he's like, I need to maybe tone this down.
Sure.
So he goes into like the heart of the world or whatever and basically changes it and saps all the human or all like the Nephilim powers or all the human power. I'm butchering this slightly, but you're getting the main gist.
No, I'm with you.
You're making all of these humans that were naturally like gods.
Yeah.
Turn them into basically just us. Like we're just human. Well, right. So it's kind of like whatever.
Yeah.
So that's what he did.
Right.
And he's like, we should just kill them all. These are abominations. This is a bad idea. We should have used protection. This is a, you know, that sort of thing.
Yikes.
And Lilith is basically like, heck no, these are my kids. Like, we're going to just destroy heaven now. So that's basically it. So she comes back and whatnot.
So they don't like each other anymore.
They don't like each other anymore. So okay. She wants to do something. We don't know what she's doing because I don't want to ruin spoilers or anything. But Anarius kills his son, Rathma. So like that's a point of contention I murdered my firstborn. And
dude, all these super happy. All these fables, man.
Yeah, right.
A lot of betrayal.
But that's basically it. So that's this game.
That's this game.
Yeah.
Who's Diablo then?
So Diablo, as far as we know, again, sure. I don't know any spoilers, and I honestly don't know the answer to the question if he's even in this game.
Okay.
He died in 3.
But then who was he? We don't know.
So Diablo was one of, like, there's Diablo and
he's
and
one of the
Bale,
kids.
And he, like, there's a bunch of evils, right?
Yeah.
So Diablo's like, you know, like, he's like terror, right? And then you have hatred, and who is, I think Mephisto, who's the mother of Lilith and all this stuff. It's like a whole demon family.
Wait,
tree.
Whoa, hey.
You have all of these main evils.
Sure.
And eventually, if you get the essences of all the evils,
yeah,
one of those evils can become the prime evil, which is what Diablo did, is I am now the biggest, baddest evil guy, right?
Yeah.
And that's the first game.
Big bad.
The main character, the character you play as,
yeah,
kills Diablo,
spoilers,
traps him into a soul stone,
okay,
and then says the only way to contain him is I'm just going to jam this stone into my forehead.
Not the power of friendship?
Right. Yeah.
Oh.
So
okay, a little curveball
for
me.
Power of friendship.
Not enough.
A darker,
darker. Okay, jams
darker
into his face. Sure.
Jams into his face.
Yep.
So as far as everyone knows, Diablo is quote unquote dead or contained.
Contained.
And this guy is just tormented for the rest of his life as like this martyr. Do you think about that as a kid,
yeah,
right? Like you're playing Diablo,
sure,
and like you beat it.
Yeah.
And then it's just like, you
face
watch
jam.
This like first person. I just smash the stone in my forehead.
Why forehead? Like, I feel like there's better
places for it. Yeah.
Like a glute, right? You know what I mean?
In your butt.
Yeah. Because like when you get a shot
in
the glute, actually hurts quite a bit, but
I feel like he is just so, like, you probably exhausted by the end of the game that he was just like, man, I don't know what to do. And he just jabs in his head.
That's a core place. I mean, I don't know if you know this, but your head is.
But then throughout Diablo 2 and the expansion and everything, eventually that guy loses control.
Who's that guy? Is that the.
That was the main character from the first game.
Oh, there's only one main character?
Well, that's who you play as.
Oh, so it could be whatever class.
Class.
I gotcha. Okay.
But anyway. Diablo
he
blows him up, takes
could
control
be a girl
of him.
Either way,
could be
okay,
but that's so interesting. So
Diablo
is like the bad guy. Actually, I don't even know if they're. I would have to check on that. I don't
Diablo
know if
one, if he could be a girl,
and, yeah,
I don't know,
probably. But anyway, Diablo comes back in 2, takes over the guy like the gem to thing in his head
face guy. Yep,
defeat him again.
Boom.
Diablo goes away.
Yep. He comes out of the face guy. And then you just beat him again?
Yeah. Now, the problem with that was they were like, hey, we need to contain him because if you just kill him, it's like he just goes back to hell, reborn, comes back.
Oh, so he's Doomsday.
Like, essentially?
No, actually.
Okay.
Well, kind of.
Yeah.
When you kill Doomsday, he gets reborn on his planet.
Is that true?
Yeah. Doomsday
or Darkseid?
No, Doomsday.
Doomsday was created as a thing, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Wasn't he a Kryptonian?
I think so. But he's like immortal because like when you kill him, I'm pretty sure I'm right about this.
All right.
Until I'm not.
Okay.
Because I'm pretty sure they put him in the Phantom Zone. Yeah. And they're like, well, he's just going to keep reviving. And then he killed himself.
Huh.
And then revived again, which was a big power move. But I think the thing with him is you can't kill him the same way twice. You're totally derailing your thing.
No,
so.
That's fine.
Sorry.
That's fine.
Anyways, continue.
Where was I? So Diablo comes back.
Yeah, you can't kill him. You got to contain him because he's Doomsday.
But then the angels kill him anyway. Oh. So then he
bad move.
Yeah, he's gone.
But he comes back.
Well, they contain him in this like they put him in like a soul stone type of thing.
Don't want to like harsh your mellow here.
Yeah.
But we're a little bit past 60 seconds.
No, I gave you the 60-second Diablo 4. Now this is the longer history behind it.
Well, I'm curious because I...
Well, you asked about Diablo, so I was like,
well,
okay,
it's,
this is like,
you know, so when he comes back... When your name's in the title.
And then Diablo 3...
Yes.
You have Deckard Cain, who's this old guy, and his, like...
Big old.
Leah, who's his, I don't know, granddaughter, niece, cousin, whatever. Like, young girl.
Okay.
She looks for her mom. Her mom turns out to be evil.
That's not good.
And then takes Diablo and shoves it into Leah, and now Diablo's...
In the face again?
No, not in the face, because she just like gets like corrupted and
in the glute?
And basically possessed.
Okay.
And then she goes and basically wages war on heaven.
Oh.
Destroys
heaven.
Which is
what they wanted to avoid.
Yeah, you don't want that. Like you want.
Well,
the,
they don't want that.
It's a cool cutscene. Like basically, like you see Leah, who's like human.
Yep.
And like this big, you know, I forget. It starts with a T. But
Tyrannosaurus.
Tyrannosaurus angel comes down and is like, you can't fool me. I know that's you, Diablo. And basically like burns him.
Oh.
And like Leah is just, she's gone. She's dead.
Oh.
And then a female-esque version of Diablo appears.
Oh.
Stabs him, smashes the gates of heaven, boom. And then they all go into heaven and just start destroying things. Anyway, then you kill Diablo.
so that's
the end of three.
You go to heaven, kill him.
And then the expansion is Mathael, which is the like angel of death, basically.
Man, I really wish I had a whiteboard.
Comes in and
I'm trying to.
Dude, it's super cool. And I can give you one, but it's like a 2-hour video of like, here's all of the things. Like,
I think I'm going to watch that.
But here's the thing, none of that, as far as I know, none of that matters.
There might be a little clues, though.
Well, they'll pop up. You'll have different characters from like Diablo 2 and stuff pop up, and they're like, oh, hey, you can make the correlation. But this is 50 years after Diablo 3.
Oh. Uh-oh.
And now Lilith is like...
mad.
Yeah, she's like, hey, I want to...
But heaven's gone.
Hell bad. Well, no, heaven was... you saved heaven.
Okay.
It's in
rebuilding.
Ruins and fire, but the angels
well,
are...
Okay.
You know, the angels get it back.
Interesting. Okay.
And that's Diablo. That's also me just going on YouTube videos because, like, I don't really care too much about the lore of Diablo, personally.
Yeah.
I think that...
You're more of a Tekken guy, right?
Yeah, more of a Tekken lore guy, Warcraft. Yeah. But I think that we will have a good time. I think it's serviceable. I think the acting's very good. I think the story is intriguing enough that you'll enjoy it, like,
as
long as you don't hate satanic stuff.
Well,
so
young we'll Tyler, see. Dude, that would have been a lot for him.
Yeah, I wouldn't have known what
maybe
to do.
Maybe that's why you like this game so much, like a little rebellious.
Maybe. I like this game because it's telling me collectibles and where those are.
When you were describing the map, I was like, oh, this is right up his alley.
It's very Guild Wars-y.
Guild Wars, one of my favorite MMO experiences. I didn't have a lot of those, so... But granted, that was when we were just exploring the world.
Every icon, so like if you have a dungeon icon, you go in, you do the dungeon, and there's a nice little green check next to it, right on the icon. So you're
I
did that one. The only problem
with
that...
No pets, though, which is, that's a minus for me.
There's got to be pets. Here's somewhere. The thing.
Maybe we'll find them.
There's an online shop.
Sure.
You can buy skins and different things already.
Yeah.
There is zero chance that Blizzard isn't going to capitalize on pets.
Do I have to go through the Blizzard
client? Yeah.
Client. Uh-oh.
Yep.
Uh-oh.
You want to know how long it's been since you've been on?
Yeah.
2 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what?
Call of Duty.
No.
Right? What was the last game?
Diablo 3.
Diablo 3. It's been 2 years since we played.
2 years.
Jeez,
it's ruined my life. Uninstalled the Blizzard client after that.
That sucks. I'm sorry, buddy.
That's okay.
Yeah.
We live and learn.
You're Respawn, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Or 1, 2, 3 spawn.
I don't know. I went through a phase.
Yeah.
Anyways,
You were asking me questions and stuff, but I forget what other questions before we started recording.
About what?
About Diablo.
No, I think you answered them. I was kind of asking how you felt about it.
Yeah.
And you went through it. I mean, like you said, I guess the summation is same formula.
Mm-hmm.
just expanding upon it. And I think that's what you have to do with a game like this, right? Like, if you just radically change it, that probably would not go over well.
It's a lot. You see a with lot this fan of base. Like, oh, Path of Exile did this smartly.
Is we Path of Exile a similar comparison?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I kind of know. I never played it, but
I would say Path of Exile is like the second
Diablo next clone. To,
yeah. And what was the Ark? Something.
I don't know.
Ark?
I don't know. Wasn't Ark the dinosaur game?
That's ARK. There was like, I don't know, Heroes of...
Heroes of the Ark?
Ark of, yeah. Ark of Heroes. I don't know. There was another
Arkham
one.
Arkham City?
Arkham City is a very good one, too.
That's a great game. Probably better than Diablo 4.
Oh, maybe. I don't know.
You don't think so?
I don't know. Yeah. Well, right now, absolutely. So here's the problem with Diablo.
Sure.
Is people that really get into Diablo, the campaign is not the draw.
Yeah.
That is 0 to 50. It is what it is. You move on. So I will have the campaign finished maybe this weekend.
It's like a Warcraft thing, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
like the grind is not the goal. The goal is the end game raids.
Well, the grind is also part of it, but it's
part of it, but it's not the fun. It's not the fun part.
Well, the grind is, but it's the post campaign grind. It's not, oh, you have to follow the story.
Right.
The entire map's open to you. Do what you want.
Gotcha.
Keep fighting the big guys. Like Jeff and Nate already lost like 2-3 characters on hardcore mode.
Oh, they're playing hardcore.
They were. Yeah.
Yikes.
I was ribbing them a little bit last night, but I hopped in and I just hear Jeff like, "Nate, get here right now!" and then he gets murdered because apparently there's a guy, the butcher, who's in Diablo 3 that's a boss.
What's his name?
The butcher.
He doesn't have a real name.
No, that's his name. He's just known as the
like
butcher.
Is it like Dave?
Dave the butcher. Yeah.
Okay.
What did I say? I'm sorry.
You just said the butcher.
Oh well, Dave.
Oh, was that
the
implied?
Butcher? Yeah.
Gotcha.
Dave the butcher, meat hook. And he throws like meat hooks out. I mean, apparently in this game, he's pretty tough.
Okay.
But
yeah, that gives me Divinity flashbacks because for some reason I'm so stubborn.
He's like, I understand Forge right now. It's like, yeah, man.
Yeah. For some reason, like I have to play on hardcore now.
The thing I don't understand is if the quote unquote real game is unlocked when you beat the campaign. So there is zero way to get a mount unless you go through the campaign storyline.
Can we play on easy?
Yeah, 100%.
Oh, perfect.
That's the whole thing is I'm playing through from 0 to 50 on, it's not called easy, it's world tier 1, right? So it's like the easy,
that's the easiest mode.
Baseline, here you go.
Sure.
You do that, get to 50, finish the campaign, unlock everything.
Yep.
Then bump up the difficulty, because if you bump up the difficulty, you get better drops and different things, and that's how you progressively scale.
Right.
But it's like, just get through.
Get over the hump.
Yeah, because like once you do that, then play your hardcore character because then you have a mount, you have all this other stuff. It's a lot more fun versus just like beating your head against this thing. Imagine going, because they got to level 30, which I just hit 30.
Okay.
You're beating your head against this thing. You die and you lose all your progress, your character, all your weapon, like just everything.
Right.
And you have to start all over. And you have to start all over to get your mount and all these other things, which is like the beginning of Act 4. So like you have to get pretty far in the game to get what you know. So I just
see, I don't get that. Like something
to
like
to each his own though, you know.
Divinity though, the point is the game. There's nothing really after that.
Exactly.
So
where this is not so much.
Right. I like the hardcore because it's like stakes.
Yeah.
And I love stakes.
I will absolutely. I made hardcore characters in Diablo 3.
Yeah.
It's just that's not going to be my first one where, like, you have to, like, you
I'm
have
you.
To beat the campaign.
Right.
Before, like, for instance, you can't play the season pass and you can't do a season until you beat the campaign.
No, I'm 100%. That makes a lot of sense. Yeah. So I would play like, on easy peasy, peasy mode.
You have a month, but maybe two. Like, you have like a month and a half to beat the campaign.
Right.
And then whenever they come out with a new season content and the battle pass and everything, then it's open to you can do whatever you want. Make a hardcore character. I think that it would be kind of cool to make four of us hardcore characters. And then eventually whenever we're feeling real badass, go into a PvP realm where it's just chaos.
Yeah.
And it's just see how you fare.
Well, PvP is probably where you lose me, but.
Well, right. But what I'm saying is like, if you really feel like you're doing well or you're doing good and stuff. Yeah. Like, I mean,
well, that's how you get humbled though.
Well, so to a point, I don't know how the world tiers work with that. So like if you're in a hardcore PvP thing, but you're world tier one, I would hope that if you go into PvP realm, everybody's world tier one and maybe they're not doing as much damage. Maybe. That's, you got to see.
I don't know.
But
yeah, it's exciting, dude. I know that you have a great love for Diablo and I want to share in that love.
It's the perfect.
So I'm ready to join you there.
It's perfect podcast.
I'm curious. I mean, like thinking long about this one.
No, that's fine.
I don't know. It's not really. It doesn't sound like my type of game, but I'm going to give it the college try.
Well, that's
try.
What I'm worried about. If it's not, like, I don't want you going in being like, I'm really excited to play through the campaign because I don't think the campaign is like.
I got
to
temper my expectations.
15, 20% of that game.
Right.
That's right. Not where the.
But you see, that's the problem because my thing is usually like the campaign's everything for me.
Exactly.
That's the problem.
But that's the thing
that's
is like if that's what you want,
yeah.
We can draw it out. Like you're gonna be doing all of the
I don't want to draw it out
stuff.
Because it's the like here's the thing, Tyler. Like there's a reason the campaign's not the real thing because like
yeah.
It's probably not as well done as like you know what I mean? Like the focus isn't there. You know what I'm saying? Not that it's bad or anything. I'm sure it's good.
Well,
but it's not gonna be like a I don't know, like a Horizon where it's like the campaign's everything.
Yeah, well,
you know what I'm saying?
I will say it's more sense? the side quests and everything are a little bit better, a little bit more than Diablo 3. Diablo 3,
sure,
it was like,
sure,
hey, go kill everything and that's
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I mean, and that's to be expected, but it's like, you know, I mean, if Johnny asks us to save his dog, I'm in, but you know what I mean? I'm sure there's going to be some side quests. It's like, okay, let's keep this moving. So we'll have to balance that out.
But the season pass, they said that it's going to focus more on story content,
okay,
which is new.
Sure.
Like that Diablo 3 was definitely not that way.
Right.
So if they can make good on that, maybe.
Yeah, maybe.
I don't know.
We'll see. Like I said, I'm going to feel it out because I don't know what to expect right now. And it's not like I like completely hate these games. Like I remember there was like a game I played back in the day on PS2 that was like a top-down hack and slash.
Yeah.
That I loved.
Yeah.
Me and Nate played it. Champions of Norrath, dude.
Yep. Yeah.
Love that game.
So I mean,
so it's like, dude, I could get into it, but I don't know.
Tons of loot. The loot's gonna get.
I don't know
bigger
what made that game special. I was just a kid. I liked it, but
yeah,
I think I gotta find the right character, and I gotta feel out how I want to play it.
That's gonna be big. So it just depends if you want to do melee or if you want to do.
I don't know. I gotta see them. Can you test their voices too? That's big for me.
You can't.
Uh-oh. Yeah. Maybe I'll go on YouTube, like kind of feel that out. That's a big one, dude. If I don't like the voice, if I don't vibe with that, I won't be able to do it.
I did the Barbarian. I love his voice. His voice is very good.
Yeah.
And all the voice actors are
I'm sure they're great. I'm sure they're great, but it's a vibe. It's not about, you know, it's not necessarily all quality. It's connection.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. We'll see. I'm excited. I just want to love what you love.
Likewise, buddy. Speaking of.
Sure.
Speaking of loving what you love.
Yeah, love.
Talk to me about this drama going on with League of Legends.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So I sent Tyler a video. Did you watch that, by the way?
I did. I understood maybe 15% of it.
That's not fair.
It did a very good job explaining it.
I was going to say, I thought it was like pretty. It was like 6-minute video.
8.
Cheeseburger?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Worst 8 minutes of my life. Anyways, so sent Tyler a video kind of explaining North America's League of Legends pro scene, the drama that's going on, which is just crazy. So, I mean, we've been speculating when, because it's been declining for years now.
Yeah, like when is it going to die?
Stuff. Like, when's it going to die, right? Nothing lasts forever. And things just seem to be coming to a head right now. Like, just things are completely on fire. And this is really, I wanted to talk about it because it's really important to me because I've been playing and watching League for like, let's think, like 2015. What is that, like 8 years? So that's a long time, right? The better half of a decade. And I don't know, it's been a really important part of my life. So many hours into that game, so many hours watching it. So essentially the TLDR, is that what that is?
Too long didn't read.
Yep. Of it is it all started a couple years ago when they did franchising. So it used to be a relegation system. If anyone knows sports, it's like soccer in Europe, they do relegation.
Yeah.
So if you're like at the bottom, you can get kicked out of a league and there's tiers, and then like the bottom tiers can move up those teams. And it was exciting and it was good. But the problem with that is you can't get big money in there because like investors are skeptical, but I guess cautious, because if your team like has a really bad season and you go out of the main thing, there's like, now the eyes aren't on you anymore, right? Because you're not in the main league.
Right.
So franchising, which is what we're used to in America, like football, all the teams are always going to exist. And all 32 teams of football every season are going to compete. They're going to exist. And that's why there's so much money behind it, because you know that the Pittsburgh Steelers are always going to be there.
Right.
Right. So they switched to franchising a couple years ago, and a ton of money got poured into the league. And
now, so just so I was understanding it.
Yeah.
They switched to franchising.
Yep.
10 teams.
Yes.
$10 million each buy-in.
Yep.
So league, like Riot made $100 million.
Yeah.
Crazy. All right, continue.
Yeah, it was a ton of money. And like the player salaries were crazy. Millions of dollars.
I just wanted to prove that I was watching the video, but go on.
Thanks, man.
Yeah.
So anyways, they did that and things were actually going pretty well for a while. But as they explained in the video, and for anyone listening, you should just watch the video. He does a really good job of kind of summarizing this whole thing. Travis Gafford is the dude's name.
Maybe I can put a link to it.
Yeah. So anyways, things are going well. The problem is that, I mean, there's a whole host of problems in North America, but essentially what was happening is a lot of imports were coming in. So
like tees and cloth and things like that.
What?
Imports.
Oh yeah. Tees, cloth. Yeah. Yep. Anyways, player imports, like specifically from Europe and like Korea, because those are like better regions. So they were pretty much just buying talent. There wasn't a lot of North America talent.
Like, why is that? Why is, like, I can understand maybe like Korea and stuff like that because they're just a different level altogether.
Right.
But like, so there, Europeans are just better at league than Americans?
Yeah, it seems
like,
that
why?
Way. I don't 100% know. I just think there's more of a player base in Europe. Okay. So you're just going to get higher quality players coming out of that system. I think there's more competition in the United States or North America in general, just because there's more games. Like, I don't know, like, you know, Call of Duty is always going to take some of your audience, you know, other competitive games are going to kind of split
so,
that up. Right.
So
you know
it's
what
less
I mean?
About the person's ability, so to speak. It's more about the competition you have in the United States is not nearly the competition that's in Europe, which means that naturally you could be the best in America, but because you don't have great opponents, you're never going to get beyond kind of like what that.
Yeah, I think that's a factor. I mean, there's not like one specific reason that you know, people try to figure out why is there a disparity, and there's like all these theories on it. Nothing's concrete, but that's kind of one of the things is like the player base is lower. You're not going to have the pool of people that you're going to have in other regions. And it's just, I think it's more popular. Like in Korea, for example, it's like super popular.
Yeah.
Right. So a lot of people aspire to do that. Where in the US, you have, you know,
still kind of like taboo.
Traditional sports is like going to be way more popular than League of Legends. Right.
You.
So, you know, even more pool of people that are drawn away from that. So, anyways, the drama is revolving around. So, when they did franchising, they did like a minor league team. So if you think about baseball, it's like AAA, for example. So every team had a minor league team to help foster that kind of talent and bring them up.
Yeah, so that's the thing. You have, hey, I'm going to pay you $10 million. You say, great, you get a team within the North American League.
Sure.
But you also need a kiddie team.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, so that was the stipulation, right?
Yeah,
and
you had
like
to
the
do both.
Thing for that is like just like in baseball, because baseball is a really good example of this, where they have a minor league team, something like football doesn't. Hockey does too, like they have minor league teams. You foster like young talent up through your system, your organization, right? And then if you're the Pittsburgh Pirates, you sell them away because you are allergic to winning.
Right.
Sorry. Anyways. So what happened recently was, and correct me if I'm wrong, because you just watched it, so it's probably fresh in your head. So what happened recently was the organizations didn't want to, they're paying too much for these minor league teams.
The Big Seven.
What?
Big Seven. Seven of the 10 organizations.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. They didn't want to pay for their minor league team. They're like, we're just wasting money on this. Like the people in these teams are not moving up because we're just importing the best players from other regions.
Yeah.
So why are we, you know, wasting money on this?
Right.
So they got together and they're like, we don't want to do this. So Riot eliminated that requirement. And that's a lot of jobs mm-hmm. that people just lose. Mm-hmm. So people were really upset in the scene. And then the players themselves, they have like an association. We're like, dude, we're not playing. This is ridiculous. Like we, you know, that's part of huge part of the ecosystem. So they,
so the quote unquote Premier League players,
yeah,
were saying, hey, that's not cool right. that you killed all the rookies.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they were they're refusing to play.
Right.
Riot responded with like, hey, season was supposed to start yesterday.
June 1st. Yeah.
And they're like, your top players don't want to play, but you got to field a team or else we're going to fine you and uh-huh. we're going to give you forfeits.
Yep.
And everyone's like, what the fuck? Like, that's insane.
Yep.
They went even so far as to like, so you have to be like Challenger, I think, to compete in mm-hmm. the, like you have to be one of the best, like yeah. obviously. Maybe it's not quite Challenger, but it's up there. And they're like, nix that requirement.
Yeah.
Like,
so
anyone can do it now.
So the way I understand it yeah. is essentially all the players went on strike.
Yes.
Right.
They're not a union, but yeah, that's what happened. Yeah. They did a walkout
so
or whatever.
So then the teams were like, well, we have to get somebody
yeah,
on you're like playing the game.
Yeah.
But all their good players weren't. Yep. They were trying to go to the rookies that they already had fired
like,
to try to get
you.
Them over. And yeah, yeah, and the rookies are like, no, like we're not going to, you know.
And then they started trying to go to colleges and stuff. And the yeah. college is like, no, dude, we're like yeah. not going to betray yeah. our buddies.
And,
our,
you know? And then at that point, it's like, well, then, and hey, John Perez.
John XP 1290 about to be on stage, dude. Yeah, exactly.
Would you do it?
No.
No.
And
is that because you don't think you could hang or just out of solidarity with the rest
of
the
out of solidarity.
Really?
Like, I respect them too much. It's like, that's ridiculous what no, they're doing
to
them.
If anyone wants to talk to good old Sir Wolfengard.
Sir Wolfengard, that would be the funniest shit.
Oh, man. That would be.
It would be hard for me to say no. Yeah. And like, maybe it would feel differently if they actually offered
right,
me.
Yeah.
But I just think it's wrong what they're doing.
That's wild. It's like, crazy. You know, that somebody's trying to build a skyscraper and like all their engineers and everything went on strike. So then they're just like, okay, look, anyone in this
yeah.
city can
exactly.
come and just build this thing for us.
A little different because this is entertainment and not
sure,
like
not right.
people's lives. But
yeah.
I 100% agree. Like, how ridiculous is that statement?
So I guess the other thing is it was supposed to be June 1st. They pushed it 2 weeks, which
yeah,
means
so
it's next week.
There was a lot of pushback and essentially Riot was like, Okay.
Let's put a pin in this.
2 weeks. There was a list of demands that the players had, right?
Mm-hmm.
So Riot said, okay, we're pushing it 2 weeks. We're going to respond. They essentially said no to all the demands.
Yeah, they're like, this is not feasible.
But we're going to do, it was like a little bit of a compromise.
Do you know
hardly.
What the list was?
I don't know the specifics.
Okay.
But it was essentially like, hey, we need $300,000 per team.
Okay.
We need the academy teams,
mm-hmm.
which is the minor league teams. And then it's like, we need funding for them. We want like a specific system
but
for development and growth.
But
this
it's
and
crazy,
that.
Right? Like, it's weird that they're doing this to Riot.
Yeah.
Not to, but you know, like they're complaining to Riot, but then the leagues were the ones
right.
that said, hey, we don't want to do this. This is a waste of money.
Right.
So like, why is that Riot's response? Like, I know Riot can just reenact that, but now won't leagues just be like, okay, forget it, it's not worth it or something
yeah,
like that?
So that was a question. I think he mentioned this in the video
maybe
briefly, but he was essentially like, you know, it's easier to go to the source, which is Riot, who ultimately makes the decisions.
Sure.
Right? Like Riot could have stood firm and said, no, you have to mm-hmm. run the minor league team. Now the problem you run into is, yeah, you start getting people up, oh, well, I'm just selling my spot. So we're at the point here. The problem it really comes down to is if everyone was making money, this wouldn't be an issue.
Right.
So the real yeah. crux of the issue is they're just not making enough money.
Yeah.
I think the problem is they try to grow too fast too quickly,
mm-hmm.
and they should have kept the relegation system. Like, hindsight 2020, of course, but like, yeah, I just think like it just wasn't sustainable. Like
yeah.
the amount of money they were getting, and it's like, you compare it to something like football, it's different because in football, you have these broadcast deals that you get,
mm-hmm.
you know, with these major networks, which is just so much money getting pumped into the league
yeah.
That you don't get because, I mean, it's streamed on Twitch and YouTube, which is completely free.
Mm-hmm.
you know, you get sponsorships and stuff, you get commercials, but that's not even close to the same amount of revenue you're going to get from like a major network. So,
and these esports teams, like these 10, is that across like other games? Like, I understand that some game, like some teams will play multiple games,
yeah.
But like the 10 from League of Legends doesn't necessarily mean it's the same for Call of Duty and different things like
no,
that.
No,
right?
Yeah, you do see some crossover. For sure, because
yeah.
These organizations, like you have an esports organization and then you kind of field whatever game you want to play.
But essentially each game could be like its own, like
yeah.
League
yeah.
of Legends is football and,
yep.
and
yep.
something
yep.
else is hockey. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And I guess there's more of a connection there.
Yeah.
Like the Steelers and Penguins would be kind of owned by,
yeah,
yeah by
yeah.
The Pittsburgh org. But
yeah.
Yeah. So anyways, they're going to be talking for 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And the big thing here is if they don't reach an agreement, the season's canceled for North America.
Yeah, I love how Riot's like, okay, we'll just take our ball
well,
and go home then.
Well,
like,
yeah, they're just, yeah. It, to me, it's like a threat. Like, mm-hmm. hey, we're going
figure
to
figure it out. Yeah.
So you know how half the people lost their jobs? It's about to be 100%.
Yeah.
Bitch. And it's like, it's just a mess. So mm-hmm. it's really troublesome for people like me who enjoy North America League of Legends.
Well, that's your spot at Worlds, right?
Yep.
So like that's the thing is if you, and I'm talking like I even know what I'm talking about, but like not that maybe North America is going to be like number one at Worlds, but
no.
Like you lose all your chances.
Yeah, 100%.
It's just,
yeah, it's like, it's like if the U.S. wasn't able to compete at the Olympics or something.
Yeah,
right?
Like I would assume that the tuning into the Olympics is going to be drastically lower if your country isn't there.
Yeah, right. It will be lower, I'm sure. But like I said, North America is not the biggest audience.
I guess
it's
a little different with esports.
But I think, you know, I don't know. Every year, Worlds is watched a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. We'll see. I hope they come to an agreement. But it's a mess. It's a total disaster. I don't know how they're going to reach an agreement. It seems like Riot's standing pretty firm on like, we're not doing this. And then the players
they got bullied out of, I don't know about bullied, but like, you know, like they got bullied out of the rookie league or the, what do they call it? The
Academy. Yeah.
So I don't know. Maybe they're just like taking a look at everything. And they're like, no, like we're freaking Riot. Like,
well, they're saying like, oh, you know, we want to cultivate growth. We want to do this and that. But mm-hmm. it's like unclear how they're going to do that. I mean,
yeah.
like you have collegiate scenes, but
it's never going to be.
I don't know.
As widely accepted as quote unquote real sports.
Yeah.
Like it's just not. Like I don't care if you're
never.
On ESPN, I don't care if like it doesn't matter.
It tries.
It's just not because you can't understand it.
I guess, but like football is not easy to understand.
To an extent. Like I feel like it's easy enough to understand when it's like, I throw a ball, this guy catches it, he hits it this end of the field. Like all the
I guess
the overarching thing, like I think the way to like to cultivate it would be like you need everyone in grade school, like starting like now.
And that's what happens in Korea.
Well, exactly.
Right.
But that's the only way
it
to
is.
Change it. And then you would have to know that like 30 years of this
yeah.
and eventually all the oldies will get like
yeah.
die off. And now we have people that are readily accepting.
Well, yeah. I mean, Korea is like, I don't even know what it is. It's just ingrained in the culture that video games are just, because like StarCraft was like their national sport or something, right?
Yeah. But that's the thing is like, you can't, like, you would need something. And like, League of Legends is probably doing this right. Cause like, you can't do a League of Legends 2. You know,
yeah,
it's not,
yeah.
you're not going to have hockey 2 or football 2. It's
right.
like, you need to continuously
yeah.
grow it. And it's just like, you have to have something so solid and so perfect of a sport. That it's not like all these constant rule changes and rebalancings and like, oh, now the items are completely different or now they do that. Like,
yeah,
that just adds like just more and more and more like confusion
yeah.
for the people watching it. So you can't have it both ways. You can't be like, oh, we want our player base to really enjoy it and really want to play it and all this stuff and keep engaged and entertained and things while we're retooling every champ and have the audience care and growth there. Like you're fighting against each other.
Well,
you know
what I mean? Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of factors to it. I mean, when you're talking about video games though, you need that constant updating or else people are not going to play your game. I mean, that's the thing though.
Like you can't, I completely agree with you.
Yeah.
But then you can't have it both ways. You can't expect the gen. Cause like I could watch football when I was a kid, never watch football and then rewatch it whenever I'm like, 50. Like, I can stop watching football now.
Right.
And in 20 years, start watching again.
Yeah.
Pretty sure I'd be okay. But no, with League of Legends, it's like you stop watching for 10 years, you know, the past 8 years, and then you watch it again. You're like, oh, there's 1,000 new champions that I don't know about, or I don't know the rules.
Yeah,
of
but
this,
I think the fundamentals stay the same. Same map. It's the same concept.
Maybe.
Where you're trying to kill the Nexus. I mean, like the goal is. But I totally understand what you're saying. Yeah, football's not going to change drastically. I know they make small changes every year, but yeah, I mean, but that's the difference between real life and video games. I mean, it's just fundamental.
100%. But that's why you aren't going to get the same level of involvement.
Yeah,
culturally,
100%.
That you do with the sports.
You can wrap your head around athletics, and it's just been around longer.
Yeah,
right.
Mm-hmm.
Like baseball's been around for over 100 years.
I mean, even look at like Fortnite, where like every kid is loving Fortnite and playing Fortnite, and eventually it's just like either you outgrow it or they have to constantly be changing it and doing different things. And it's
but
like
that's
it just
the landscape of video games.
Yeah,
which is I guess what you're saying is that it's always destined to like.
What I'm saying is you need a video game that stays quote-unquote pure and just like this is a very simple game to understand.
Like CSGO.
And that's it, yeah.
But
CSGO is a perfect example of that, yeah.
But the watch experience with CSGO is so much worse than League of Legends.
Yeah, and it all depends on like the shot colors and stuff.
Right, and because it comes down to, I mean, I've talked about this. First-person games are just not an enjoyable way to experience like a competitive game. It's possible and people do and people love it, but the fact that you have a game where the same exact camera angle you play is how you watch is huge.
Yeah.
Can't be understated. So
I think you also need something that like if you look at sports and you look at the breaks. So like football, you play a down or play four downs and then there's like a little intermission or whatever like that. And like people can like between each play, they can like, oh, I think they should do this, this, this. You don't get that in games. Games are just constant.
That's why I love, I don't think that's a great example because you have something like hockey that's also constant. It does have more breaks than League of Legends.
I was going to say, there's still breaks there.
But there's downtime in League of Legends. Definitely. Where we can have that commentary.
Yeah,
like
I guess
like
true.
If you
yeah.
kill a big team fight,
mm-hmm.
and then someone wins the fight, they go get Baron,
that's
and
fair.
Then they recall. Yeah, you have a good minute.
I was thinking more on like the CSGO side, but even CSGO like, well, you still have rounds.
Between rounds, absolutely, So there's breaks. There's definitely great commentary to be had there, and I think that's where a lot of it comes into as well, where you need a really good caster to break down kind of what's going on and help someone who maybe isn't as...
Yeah.
Engrossing it, but you need a baseline understanding because they're not going to be like, hey, here's a minion and right. So yeah, I don't know. It's not sustainable, right? No game's going to be sustainable. It's going to end sometime. It looks like it'll end here first before it ends Europe or Korea or China.
Yeah.
Which is really sad, but I'm hoping they can reach an agreement. And
what do you think that would look like? Like, what would the agreement be at that point?
I actually have no idea.
Yeah.
I don't have a lot of faith in it, if I'm being totally honest, because...
So when it boils down,
it depends
like, there,
who's
going to
cave.
Enough people?
Who's going to cave? And Riot's not going to cave. So it's going to come down to the players. Are they going to just kind of accept their fate?
Yeah.
And I, you know...
I wonder if Riot could just open it up and facilitate a tournament on their end.
Yeah, I think... Like just, I said, like, I think public. The franchising was the nail in the coffin, and we didn't see it at the time, but now I think you have to rethink how to make video games in a competitive sense economically viable, and the tournament structure seems to be the route that kind of is better for that, rather than trying to mimic traditional sports. It just doesn't seem like I personally like the traditional sports structure better because to me, like old school league or like, I don't know, fighting games, for example, is a good one where it's like, there's no there are circuits for fighting games, but it's more tournament. Like here are the tournaments. Evo's like a big one. Right. But there's not like a season that you follow and then a championship. It's more, okay, you're coming to this tournament. You're coming to that tournament. More like tennis, right?
Yeah.
Or golf. Tennis and golf are good examples of this, where you have that kind of structure of
That's a good point. Yeah.
Yearly tournaments and stuff. But again, yeah. In golf, you have the Masters. That's humongous. You have the US Open. So you have these kind of big pivotal things, you, which you I think have you have then fighting
the
games.
Worlds of everything. Yeah. Like you have like the Super Bowl of whatever.
But I like the football, hockey, baseball structure. Here's your regular season. Here's the playoffs. Here's the championship. I personally like that better. Some people are different.
But that's what they have currently, right?
That's what they're doing for league.
Yeah.
But something like fighting games, mm-hmm. like Street Fighter VI competitive will be tournaments hosted throughout the year.
Yeah.
And maybe that's the route you have to go in terms of, I don't know. It's tough to say. That's how leagues started, right?
Yeah.
You had tournaments, and then they created the league itself.
Well, I didn't even know there were seasons. Like that's intriguing me because like I'm with you. I think that just naturally I like that. I just in my mind, it's like, that makes more sense to me. If you pick your one of 10 teams that you enjoy, follow their season, cheer them on, do whatever. And I can equate that to like a sports team. And like,
I will say also the problem is when it comes to sports teams, for example, I am a fan of all the New York teams. My father was born there.
Yeah.
I love the city itself, so I kind of gravitated towards that when I was young, and now I'm a fan of like all the New York sports teams, and that's a location based.
Yeah.
Like if you're from Pittsburgh, you're probably going to root for the Steelers, Penguins, etc. You don't get that in
where are most of the teams from?
Well, that's the problem. In league, they're
just all over.
All LA. Right.
Yeah.
Takes place in LA.
Okay, I got you.
And they don't have their team, it's just organizations, right?
Yeah.
So you corporate. Get this problem where it's like the top five teams, everyone has all the fan base, and then the teams that suck have no fan base.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's tough because it's like, even if you're the Pittsburgh Pirates, which are terrible year in and year out.
Still got people rooting for you.
Yeah, because you're loyal to your city. If you have a location-based team, you're going to get that buy-in just because you're from there.
Yeah.
So they tried to do this in Call of Duty where they have like city names for teams, but it just, I feel like it doesn't work as well
because why?
In Call of Duty, at least you have tournaments you're going to. It's not like you're going to travel to Houston to play the Rockets or whatever. I don't know what the
Call
of Duty teams are.
Tournament.
But you're going to a tournament
somewhere,
localized.
Right? Like I could see if it's like, okay, you're going to a tournament. This tournament's in LA, but everybody from across the country is coming and doing it. And eventually I could see where it'd be like, you know, like you're...
But that's so expensive.
Yeah, but you're paying $10 million to be part of the freaking league anyway, man. Like you got to get that somewhere.
I guess. I just think, I don't know, it's tough. Because it's like if you are going to have a city name behind your team, you have to be located in that city, in my opinion.
I'll solve this for you right now.
Okay.
How many people are on a Call of Duty team?
Five?
I think. Okay, fine.
Well, probably like 10, a sub.
Whatever. But
less than that, but sure.
But okay, let's say you have 10.
Sure.
Coaches, all that stuff. 10 people.
Sure. Okay.
Follow the NFL's schedule. And they just go with the players. Give them $1,000.
But the problem is you don't have 32 teams.
But what I'm saying is get the 32 teams. Like if you have an NFL team, you have a Call of Duty team.
Well, here's the problem with that.
And just literally follow the same schedule.
If you have 10 teams for league and the bottom three are just trash and don't have a chance, imagine what the 32nd team is going to look like. It's going to be me on that team.
Yeah.
Like, do you have enough people?
But how cool would it be if I have the black and gold t-shirt?
Yeah.
I got Perez on my back.
Just swoop in with them.
Do
you imagine?
What have you got to lose, man?
Sitting next to Kenny Pickett.
Just hang out.
I'm the mid laner for the Pittsburgh Knights.
Nothing is going to get you closer to,
to
sports status.
Yeah.
And is just like, we see this team literally right next to the football players. And it's like, okay, equate that.
Yeah.
Play after or right before. I mean, you're the opening act to the football games or right after them or whatever.
I think you'd have a better chance of having like a Rainbow Six team or a Call of Duty team. Because I just think like people who watch football probably going to gravitate more towards the shooters or like something like that rather than like league. League is like you're a nerd and that's kind of, what I'm saying? But like people who play like Siege, it's like mainstream people.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I don't know. But I totally understand what you're saying. Yeah, you need that kind of boost.
Well, that's what I was... I don't know. I mean, it's never going to happen.
It's an interesting idea, though. That would be cool.
I would buy before I bought like a Pittsburgh Steelers jersey or whatever, I would, if I could actually hang my hat on I think that's a perfect point that you made, where it's like, if I could be like a black and gold, like, yeah, this is my e-sport team, yeah, of Pittsburgh.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
That would be cool. I do like that idea.
I don't care about FaZe or whatever the other 10 are. You know what I mean? Like, is FaZe even one of them?
It is.
Yeah.
But like, I don't care. It would be like the Pittsburgh FaZe or whatever.
Yeah, if it's only Pittsburgh and they had to live in Pittsburgh.
Right.
Like, I don't want, like, oh, everyone actually is in the California, but it's just a Pittsburgh branded team.
Right.
That doesn't cut it.
Exactly.
They have to live in the city.
Care about the city. Yeah. That would be cool.
Yeah.
That would be cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We could save it.
We can save it. I just don't think, like, the NFL teams would give a fuck.
So, I mean, do we really only have a week now? So this comes out on Monday. Do they only have a week, or they have 2 weeks from...
2 weeks from yesterday.
2 weeks from the first. Okay.
Yeah, so not next week, but the week prior. Or not prior. After.
So we'll be talking about this soon then.
Yeah.
Get Jeffy Boy on here and talk about
it. Yeah, I don't know.
I
know Jeff's super into league, obviously. I don't know how much he watches the competitive scene, but yeah, I don't know. It's been really brutal because we talked about Bjergsen retiring, which is a big hit. And then this. So it looks like it's coming to an end.
The research department, like, competitive, I assume, right?
Yeah, big time.
Maybe, maybe bringing him on.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I'm sure. I'm curious what his thoughts.
Or research department and Jeff, and then I just sit there like a...
That would be hilarious.
I don't know.
No, I think you have a lot of great thoughts about it. You just saved it with your idea, so...
Yeah, you're welcome, Rhett.
Yeah, but I don't know. We'll see.
Sweet.
Yeah.
It's good.
That is good.
Good episode.
Yeah. I'm so sad.
I'm sorry, bud.
I don't want it. It's like 8 years, bro.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Something's got to come up, right? Like, something's got to replace. I guess not. Maybe not. Like, with
my
like,
hope is
StarCraft.
Like, Arcane did really well.
Yeah.
My hope is that it lives on maybe through other mediums, but it might be coming to a close here. So we'll see.
What's the prize? For like the season, like you do the season, like what do you win? Or is it
the
like
prize isn't a lot over? Because you have a contract. It's like traditional sports. Like you have a salary.
Yeah. Okay.
So whereas like in fighting games, that's the rub of it. You have to win.
But
to really make a lot of money.
Is there like a, so if it's, I mean, maybe I'm too into football, but is there like a division championship before going to like Worlds?
Nah. Well, it's by regions, I guess, is the only way to kind of do that. So you have like North America, you have Europe's a region, China, Korea.
So you have like
those are the four main regions. I guess you could kind of think about that as divisions and like grand scheme of things.
Well, I guess what I'm saying is like you have those 10 teams, they're playing a full season.
Yep.
They're only playing against themselves.
Right. And then they go to Worlds, which is unlike...
But who goes to World? Like all 10 teams just
go
to Worlds?
No, top like three teams.
Okay, that's
or
what,
whatever. Yeah. Right.
Mm-hmm. So that's really what you're playing for within your season is just being the highest record within your season so you could go to Worlds and be
one. Yeah, you obviously want to win your season and championship at home.
Yeah.
But that's the interesting thing where it's unique from like other sports because you have a championship from the season you played, but then you go on to this like world tournament.
Yeah, where it's just completely...
Yeah, which is super cool. I love that format.
Yeah.
And you get to compete against the world. So kind of unlike anything else, really.
Yeah, like soccer. How's that, right?
Yeah, I guess so.
Worlds is every year.
What?
Like the world. Like Worlds is every single year. It's not like every 4 years.
Yeah.
It's not like the
annual.
World Cup or
yep.
something.
Yeah, annual. Okay. Yep. So, yeah, so we'll see. I don't know, man. I've just been playing a lot of Balloon Tower Defense.
Yeah.
Actually, I was rage queuing last night at League of Legends. It was so bad.
Yeah.
Kept losing, so I just was playing until like 2 a.m.
Sorry, buddy.
Dude, if you get into the rage queue, it's not a good time.
I don't think any of it's a good time, personally, but I can understand.
The problem is, like, you start losing, and you're like, dude, I suck.
Yeah.
And you're about to go to bed, and you're like, no.
I'm better than
I'm
this.
I'm not old. I'm not too old for this.
Yeah.
I still have it.
Yep.
And you keep playing. Luckily, I did... win a couple, so
that's good.
Usually what happens is you lose like six in a row, it's 4 a.m. and you're like, okay, I do suck.
Yeah.
And then you go to bed and you cry yourself to sleep, but We brought it back a little bit.
Remind me to tell you something very dark off air, okay, so we don't get canceled.
Perfect.
Cool.
Yeah, but I've been playing Blue Entire Defense because that might be the greatest game ever made.
It's very fun. We finally got past our hump. We're moving on.
Town Center.
Yeah.
Wow, what a tough map.
That was a very tough map.
That was a tough, toughie. But we learned the Ice Monkey is so overpowered.
Yeah, we never use them.
For round 63. And then what else did we discover? Adora is huge.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
We discovered the tower, the, I don't know, tree tower. What is it? The
tree stump?
No, not the tree stump. The, like, what's the monkey tower? Like, the village. Monkey village is pretty good.
Oh, yeah. Monkey village, yeah, with, like, all the primaries. Yeah.
Yeah.
And we did just rocket
spam. If no
spam.
One's ever done Balloon's Tower Defense, they have no idea what we're talking about. But it's a very fun game. You should play it.
No, it's so good. It's like $3.
Yeah.
Crazy. So much content.
I think it's 14 full price.
It's like always on sale, though.
Yeah, it's always on sale.
So that's what I've been doing. I don't know, man.
They need a new one. Unreal 5. Just put it in.
They're not going to do that. I think they are working on the next one, though. They just came out with a patch for it.
Oh, yeah?
I was going to send you the video.
I'd play that.
They came out with a Wizard Monkey Paragon.
Oh, really? Yeah,
it's sick. It's just a combination of all three.
That's kind of cool.
You have like a phoenix going, you have the undead balloons, yeah, and you just destroy it. It's like he's so overpowered.
Okay.
Yeah. It's cool.
Play that.
Yeah. All right. Well, anything else you want to talk about?
That's it. Diablo and League of Legends. Two biggies.
Santa Claus.
Yeah. Might be next week. I played a typing RTS.
What?
Yeah, it's like, okay, if you play RTS but you don't use your mouse, you just type words to move around.
Sounds
the map
awful.
And tell, yeah, it's fun if you're
Sounds
into
like
keyboards and you want to just a game that does typing.
Least favorite things in the whole world.
Yeah, and then I tell you it's like it's puzzle based.
Yeah, it's a puzzle and it's also an MMO.
Yeah.
All right, well, that's all we got.
Yeah.
Thanks for joining us. If you made it this far, check us out on couchcompany.games, at couchcogames on Twitter, and we will probably be seeing you next week.
Yeah.
Definitely. Same time, same place. Thanks for joining us on the couch.